This is the tale thus far. The Rydal Road. A temple was found, and the turn of a key woke a giant from slumber. The makers have need of me, the warden bellowed. And so he went, in search of their only hope.
Waiting. Stay there. I'll get the door. Let her drop.
It's all right. I've got you.
Oh, you jumped like a lass.
Thank you. If you ain't up to the task, perhaps I need to find myself another rider. After you. Run along, Ryder. I'll rest a bit. You got this one. After you. I'll wait here. You go on ahead. If I try that, I'd break my neck. After you. How about it then? Run along, Ryder. I'll rest a bit.
Alright. Let's see if this is working better. Yeah, okay, that works. So, sorry about the tech difficulties, guys. I did test this microphone yesterday and at the beginning of the stream, and it worked fine, so I don't know why it stopped working in the middle. That's gonna look amazing on YouTube. Yeah, I'm sorry, guys. So anyway, I just picked up the Maker Armor. Wanted to show you guys what it looks like when you equip it all. And what I was saying before, for you guys probably couldn't hear it, I find it really weird that really hilarious that the description for this says that the makers basically made this for a champion who would rise against the corruption. I'm like, so the corruption came to your realm, wrecked everything, and you just decided, well, better craft some armor in case somebody comes along who could help us. Like, what was the thought process there? But oh well. Anyway, this armor is actually the best armor that we currently have, so we're definitely gonna keep on wearing that. We are going to switch back to a different pair of scythes, though. Back to our health steel scythe. And, okay. Here's the problem with this mic that I currently have. It's essentially a microphone extension for a headphone, and the headphones don't work with, like, the connector for the headphones is actually broken, so while you guys can hear me half the time, I don't hear the game sound, which is kind of inconvenient. But anyway, we'll make it work. And I'm sorry if I confused you guys with the stream yesterday, but that one was literally just a test if the microphones work. Which obviously now we know they don't exactly as they should. So yeah, live, everybody! Anyway, you didn't miss much in terms of lore, because there really was not all that much to talk about. If I'm gonna be using this microphone, I'm gonna have to turn down my game sound again, because right now it's really loud in my ear. So, just give me a second. Okay, much better. We really gotta do everything ourselves around here. Couldn't even get Karn to move this bowl for us. Oh, and I see there's a piece of armor I didn't even pick up.
I'll wait here. You go on ahead. After you.
Now that said, he is going to make for a very nice distraction, because as we go in here, you can see it in the background already, there's another earth crag rising from the ground. We're just gonna let Karn deal with that, and we're not gonna bother with it. So he can beat the crap out of that while we go and get the Heartstone. There we go. I will admit that this area tends to be very glitchy for me. Like, half the time Karn just does not show up to carry the stone. So I'm really glad he actually did it today on stream. And we are about to encounter one of my least favorite enemies. These fuckers here. Who can freeze you with that specific attack. So, every time you fight one of these nightmare prowlers or ice prowlers, just be very, very careful. Oh, fuck, more of these. And I love how Karn just waits for us to put that stone in. Like, you could already get the party going, guys. You could just put that stone in the Guardian already, but no, you're gonna have to wait for me for the cutscene.
From the heart to the stone, the lifeblood flows.
And yeah, got tripped up there by the insurmountable little ledge there. Alright, and off to the last heartstone. This is a much faster one. And hello, Bronar, to the chat.
Step up, Ryder. I'll toss ya. After you.
Yeah, give me a minute, Karn. I gotta open up that gate first.
I think that's it.
Alright, now you can already see that something is wrong with this heartstone. There's corrupted crystals all over, and this thing does not look healthy. What you want to do first is you want to get all of these crystals on the ground out of the way, because we're about to get into a boss battle here, and you can and will get stuck behind these crystals. So it's safer to just get rid of all of them. Alright, now we can actually get to work. Oh, whoa, whoa, whoa. Nearly jumped into the wrong direction there.
Thank you.
There's something wrong with this one.
No, you don't say. Well, unfortunately, we now have to end this poor custodian here. And this is essentially what happened with every single construct in the Forgelands, aside from the Guardian that we got from the Lost Temple. Ouch. And the ones that were inactive and that we just brought to life recently. Crit chance on my gear, because right now my stats are absolutely not working in my favor. Gonna take it for now. But yeah, considering that there's an entire soul of a maker in there, that's gonna be kind of awful being stuck in stone while your soul is getting corrupted by whatever the hell corruption actually is. So, and basically you are nothing more than a stone at that point, so it's not even like you can do anything about it.
The stone into the Guardian.
We've seen its work, Horseman. Corruption fair weeps from it.
The other two Hearthstones were pure. I'm wagering that their radiance will cleanse the third.
Mayhaps.
Khan, the greater risk is to do nothing.
Aye.
Seriously? You couldn't just take this thing back to Tristone and have, like, maybe Nuria try to, perform some magic on this thing and purify it before you put there.
The corruption has burned off like rain on a hot forge! You were right!
I was wrong.
And that is saying something, because Seth is not very good at admitting when he's wrong. He just tends to quietly acknowledge to himself that he's wrong, and then try to fix whatever he did without actually telling anybody about it, so... This is actually character growth for him. Alright. So, wonderful. Now we gotta hunt down this construct. And Karn is not gonna follow us, even if you try to talk to him. So we're just gonna make our way back to Tristone. Did we get everything that we should be able to get from this area? Just gonna double check. Yeah, looks good. And as you can see, the huge hammer is gone, so that is totally not going to come back to bite us in the ass. I will say this, we are going to stock up on health potions before we fight the Guardian, because we are playing on normal, which means he'll still be okay, but on higher difficulties, the second part of that fight can just absolutely wreck you. depending on how lucky you get with his attacks. Because it is very much a matter of luck, in my experience. So this place looked better before, but at least our warden friend is still alive. At least he didn't get trampled, so that's good.
Wake up, little one. There is work to do.
Wake up? Like, I have not been running around for hours fixing this entire realm. Seriously. And there is a certain hilarity to these dialogue options here.
The guardians run wild! He's gone mad, horseman! Idar doesn't know! Browse around. We have new items.
Oh no, you gotta help us! The guardian has gone mad! Oh, by the way, do you want an axe? Like, maybe later, Alia? I think we have more important things to worry about. Yeah, so the guardian definitely did a number on this place.
The darkness has risen all around us. You're back.
So little faith, shaman. Here are your seeds.
It is rare that I encounter one whose motives are so difficult to read, but you have my thanks. What was old is new again.
Okay, let's see. Let's see if she actually has a good talisman with critical chance. I might just buy that because we haven't found a single one with critical chance all on our own. So, it's not the best, but I'll take it because at this point I just need any amount of critical chance, really.
I would not burden you, horseman.
Oh, that's very kind of you. Okay, lodestone. A lodestone is naturally and forcefully drawn to objects in of the same material. Should a lodestone be somehow carved in two, the separate parts will actively seek to be reunited. So this is how we're going to find the Maker's Chronicle, because they were both made
as
from the same
read,
stone.
I will sow the same.
And we're going to get to that after we have defeated the Guardian, obviously. Saving this place kind of takes precedence, so... Okay, now let's see what Fane has to say, and then we can go and fight the Guardian.
No. This can't be. The stone bastard.
Tell me where to find the Guardian.
Head to the plains outside the city, and hurry! Adar is waiting for you both.
Wait, can I actually still train with you? Oh yes, I can. Awesome. Okay, let's go and fight the Guardian. This boss fight has the best music in the game, or one of the best pieces of music in the game. But like I said, the second part of this fight is very much down to chance, and I do not like it. Thank you.
Maker's bones. That hurt.
Not gonna lie, pretty badass grandpa.
It beyond my help, horseman. Do your worst.
Alright. Let's get to it. Let me actually turn down the sound for the sound effects, because this is way too loud. Come on. Just try to hit me, please. Can we please get on with it, please? Yes, there we go. Part of the fight that I absolutely hate. Oh, because sometimes you will just ride directly into this thing and there's nothing you can do about it. Come on, spit out another one of those bullets. Thank you. And now, good luck doing enough damage to this with your gun before it tries to hit you. Move. That actually went really well today. I swear sometimes it takes me like 20 tries to actually get that bomb that he shoves at us to go where I wanted to go. Or to hit it often enough. Alright, and now we get the Dark Talons. A dead lord loyal to the deposed King Argul, all of which basically tells us nothing so far, but we will meet the dead lords of the current king, the Lord of Bones, soon enough. A dead lord loyal to the deposed King Argul forged his claws from the heart of a glacier. When Argul was overthrown, many of his lieutenants were destroyed and the Dark Talons were fought lost forever. These weapons, seethed with the essence of deep winter cold, every strike freezes the blood of its victims. Those enemies that the claws freeze into immobility are even more vulnerable to its touch, suffering horrendous wounds from any follow-up attacks. Which is gonna sell it, honestly.
You had no choice but to destroy him, horseman. Yet if the path to the Tree of Life is to be cleared, I have no choice but to bring him back.
How many times would you have me kill him?
The Guardian will be as a newborn, free of corruption. Now, stand aside. This will take more than a small effort.
You won't survive this!
I am a maker! That task defines my very purpose, as the reaping of souls defines your own. There is no escaping it! Get to the tree now, horseman. Your journey is far from over.
And there we go. Adar essentially turned himself into the third and fresh, untainted Hearthstone required for this guardian. And you gotta remember, like, these few makers are all that's left. Like, most of their race is already dead. So they really cannot afford to lose anybody else, and yet Adar is gone. And he was one of the older makers. Like, he was there before the angels and the demons. And what's even sadder here, as we go through this cutscene, is that we can now finally access the tree. So this corruption is gone, but so is the Guardian as well. There were three makers that had to die for this Guardian. Four, if you count Adark, because the one of the first three got corrupted. Four makers that had to die for this Guardian and completely annihilated in the effort to destroy this corruption. And this is not even all the corruption. This is just a bit of corruption. There is still so much more of this stuff in the universe. So that's just a tremendous loss. And yeah. So now we can finally access the tree if we wanted to. We are going to do a tiny little bit of backtracking here. First and foremost, we are going to teleport back to the city. And we're going to talk to everyone about everything that happened here. And then I think we're going to do the Shadow Forge and the Lost Forge, the Shattered Forge. In the Shadow Gorge. I feel like somebody could make a tongue twister out of that to finish Alia's quest. And this will also give us a Book of the Dead page, which is actually really important.
You fought the Guardian with skill and cunning. I suppose you might make a warrior yet.
Why, thank you. Didn't see you helping out.
You saved our realm, Rider, and for that, you have my gratitude. But only time will tell if your path leads into darkness, or if it leads out.
Why build constructs? You make us seem sturdy enough.
Even we must eventually pass from this life. But our spirits are far too ancient to be drawn to the dead city. We must instead become one with the forest, or take up a body of stone.
If constructs are dead makers, you think there would be more of them?
Once there were many constructs in the halls of the Stonefather. But corruption has claimed most of their number, and ours as well. I searched for a way to give life to stone without sacrificing the soul of a maker. But I cannot say that life is what I gave my creation.
Something went wrong.
The construct was consumed by fire, rage boiling up from the abyss. It killed one of our young ones and fled into the Charred Pass. I do not wish to see my creation destroyed, but it must not harm anyone else. I need you to kill it.
Yikes. So, I always feel so bad for Muriel. Like, she just wanted to do something useful, and it ended up getting a child killed. Which, again, considering how few makers there are left, is actually really, really even worse than it normally would be. And yeah, like she said, makers can either become constructs or they become one with the forest. And the forest is currently corrupted. Most of the constructs have been corrupted, so not just the living makers are fucked, but all the makers are fucked right now.
You had trouble raising weeds. Why create a construct?
We are a people of stone, born of the fires beneath the earth. I captured a spark from the heart of the Stonefather to bring my creation to life, but it wouldn't stop burning. And soon, his pain turned to rage.
And think about how utterly terrifying this must have been from the construct's perspective as well. Because essentially, she gave this construct life, but without actually having anything like a maker's personality, memories, etc., that would normally go along with having a life. Like, it's basically, like, imagine an AI or a virtual intelligence becoming an actual artificial intelligence, becoming actually sentient. Like, that is essentially what's happening here. For those of you who have played Mass Effect, what happened to this construct is pretty much what happened to the AI on the moon in Mass Effect. So that's actually kind of terrifying, because that poor construct also did not know what the hell was going on, only that it was burning inside. And yeah, apparently, those fires are also fueled by the abyss, and yeah, not a good idea.
I've slain constructs before, Shaman. How will I know when I've killed yours?
He has taken to calling himself Gorn. The word I know not, but I sense it is ancient, a word of fire. It wells up from within him and spells onto the earth.
Fire or blood, I will drain him of both.
There are new talismans.
No problem, I got you. I'll just kill it for you. Okay, we're just gonna sell some stuff because we have a whole bunch of shit that we don't need.
My thanks.
We are going to keep the legendary equipment aside from the secondaries, because for the secondaries there's just not enough room in our inventory to collect them all. But for the rest of it, we can actually keep the legendaries.
I will offer this to the forest.
Now, that said, we are not going to go and fight that construct yet, because Death may be eager to throw down with him, but I'm not. Many of the enemies in that place are level 15. We are currently level... Are we at level 12 now, or are we still level 11? We're still level 11. So, not a good idea.
You go on without me, horseman.
I've had my fill of adventure.
Oh, thank God. I was afraid you were going to send me to look for something in the Kingdom of the Dead or something.
I can't believe Idar's gone. I never thanked him for all he did.
All right, so time to do some side questing. The first thing we're going to do is we're going to go over to the Baneswood. And there's going to be two things that we're going to do here. The first one is we're going to pick up the Maker's Chronicle. And the second one is we're going to go to that ruin in the east of the Baneswood and get the Boatman coin that we can now finally access over there. So, here is the Chronicle. Very secret, very hidden. Absolutely not accessible for giant constructs. But yeah, that book might look giant to us, but imagine how tiny this is compared to a Maker's hands. Like, just writing in that thing must be absolute terror. The Maker's Chronicle is the recorded history, lore, culture of the beings known as the Makers. The epic narrative carved in the stone captures the spirit of the Maker people. So it's kind of like a giant Edda of Maker's history and lore. And basically, if you wanted to like have a comprehensive story of what are Makers, you would be reading this book. And supposedly Auron can use this to heal this realm, which would be really nice. Okay, Wrath on crit is not that important for us, we're not gonna equip that. Alright. Just gonna get rid of this one. And then we are going to go to the fjord. We're gonna hand this book in to Auron. And then we're going to go to the Shadowed Forge in the Shadow Gorge. I will not say that three times fast because I will just completely hate myself. But yeah, the good point about finishing this Shattered Forge side quest is that it will allow us to get 10 Book of the Dead pages. And we are going to need 20 Book of the Dead pages by the time we get to level 17. In order to get into the Kingdom of the Dead Death Tomb and make ourselves
this
a good
is
possessed
no place
life.
For a horse.
So it's really important that we try to get these as soon as possible. And he's floating, look at that.
Here is your history, Auron.
The Chronicle. At last. It is though the very souls of the Makers remain close to us through this tablet. You understand, I'm sure. Death. You are not so cold as you would have us all believe.
Well, keep that to yourself, old one.
Ah, Jesus Christ.
I have to go alone.
So yeah, Death can actually be nice when he wants to, but unfortunately he won't let anybody know about it. And yes, Michael Wincott's delivery on that line is absolutely spot on. Oh my god, we can finally level up our skills. Thank you, baby Jesus.
This is no place for a horse.
So now we will actually have some relatively decent critical chance on our attacks. And we might actually get something out of that health on crit life that we are currently carrying around. We're not going to bother with this hive. Come on. You just please. There we go. So there is Valus's hammer, Splinterbone, very nicely packaged up into a chest by some kind creature that found it in this dungeon. So yeah, remember this was the dungeon where they had essentially thought, oh maybe we can turn this into a new forge, and nope, it's infested with corrupted creatures, too bad. Pick up the map. So, a relatively small dungeon. Shouldn't take us long to get through. But this dungeon is especially important to complete if you are planning on building a good possessed scythe for a necromancer, because you will need access to all the vendors to quickly get your equipment, and Alia will actually only offer you the really good stuff after you finish this dungeon and hand her the hammer. So if you want to build a possessed scythe for a necromancer, really recommend doing this dungeon as soon as you can, which is technically you get the quest a lot earlier than this, but the problem is you will need the death grip for at least one point in this dungeon. So there's no point in coming here until after the foundry. There we go. No! Fuck, that's not what I wanted to do. This is what happens when you play several of these games at the same time. You end up messing up your button prompts. That was a button prompt from Darksiders Genesis that I just did there. Which is completely useless for us right now. The Omega Blades were built piece by piece from the shattered weapons of slain angels. When wielded, the Omega Blades ignite with raging fires. Each strike of the scythes can cause opponents to erupt into flames, and those flames can spread to nearby enemies. This effect, known as the Omega Fire, consumes all those who oppose the balance. That kind of sounds like it was made, like, by orders of the council, with this entire oppose the balance trick. But at least it was only made from the shattered weapons of slain angels and not from, you know, actual slain angels, which is a big improvement over how the Nephilim originally went about weapon building, so... Because the very first weapons that the Nephilim built for themselves were, according to the novel, the Grand Abominations, and those were actually made from the... But they were some of the very first weapons. And they were actually made from the dead bodies of another species, which did not turn out great for anyone involved. Oh, look. It's a level 4 stalker. Oh no. Whatever shall I do? We're about 8 levels too high for this dungeon, and it's hilarious. And there we go. Quick and easy. Oh, there's another one. Okay. Cool. Careful right now. And we are actually getting some health back now, which is great. Like, we actually have enough critical chance to actually get something from our health on crit, which is awesome. Alright. Let me please get both of these on the first try, please. No! Fuck. That's what I was afraid might happen. We should still be able to go all the way over here, I think. Yeah, I'm not going back there just for one tiny little chest. Fuck it. Ooh, nice. Possessed. With frost damage. Huh. Don't really care about that. We could just drop down there. Thank you. And oh, look at our most favorite corrupted enemies again. Yeesh. Leave me alone, dude. You're level 5, I'm level 12. This is suicide, come on. There we go. Now, critical chance, but about only half the damage of what we're currently doing, so fuck that. And there's our Book of the Dead page for an entire Book of the Dead chapter. We are going to hand this in to Volgrim the next chance we get, but we are not going to access that specific tomb just yet, because we want to wait until we have the Demon Heart Talisman, so we can use the weapon racks there to actually build a nice scythe for ourselves. And yeah, we're just gonna leave that chest over there alone. Like, it's just a normal loot chest. I don't care. This is not a 100% completion run, so screw that. I'm not going back just for that. Okay, Splinterbone. In the hands of a skilled blacksmith, this hammer grants the ability to forge powerful weapons and armor. Return this item to Valis and Tristone. So I'm guessing this is the heads up in case you didn't pick up the quest from Alia. This is just the game telling you, oh, this is where you need to go.
Interesting.
Now, as for the question from the chat about the Book of the Dead pages, who they belong to, how they've been scattered, we unfortunately never find out. And what do you mean, fast travel? Impossible. Like, come on. Game. There we go. So, unfortunately, we don't know how these pages came to be scattered, or who's even responsible for the Book of the Dead. Could be either someone from the Kingdom of the Dead, or it could be whoever is in charge of the Well of Souls, which in this case would be Azrael. I think those would be the most likely candidates. And if it was Azrael, that would, well, if it was in both cases, there would be a good explanation for why they are scattered. If it's in the hands of the Dead Lords, it's because they have basically abandoned their posts because of corruption, and if it was Azrael, it would be because Azrael got attacked and imprisoned by the Destroyer, so both those scenarios are possible, but we will never find out for sure.
I believe you were looking for something.
Oh, Splinterbone! You found it! I don't know what to say.
Mm-hmm. I leave you to your work, Valis. Mm-hmm.
Should you come this way again, you may find items of even greater power.
So, from this point onward, Alia is basically selling us all the good stuff. Once we hit the right level, she will start selling items with health steal, arcane critical chance, Rough steel, all of the good stats that you don't normally find on normal weapons. She's gonna sell them all from now on, provided we have reached the right level, because half steel weapons and rough steel weapons don't usually show up unless you are above level 15 or so. And if you want to make yourself a good possessed knife for a necromancer, your best options are health steal, wrath steal, and arcane crit chance on the weapon. And so you will need three stats that are completely very, very rare to get in game, and you will likely have to farm the vendors for those. So you definitely want to have Alia available for that. And yeah, we also never find out what exactly Bulgrim wants to do with the Book of the Dead pages, which is honestly more concerning than the thought of where they come from. But not questioning what somebody wants to do with something is kind of a running theme in this game. Like, Uriel also just straight up leads us to a massively powerful angelic weapon without even asking us what we intend to do with it. So everybody's judgment is a little bit lapsing here. This scene starts the whole creepily. I love it. It starts so creepy. And then it becomes completely lame.
And so you have come. Bearing your sin like a badge of honor. What do you seek? Pale Rider.
The return of mankind.
To a barren planet shorn of life. Oh, humans are weak and simple. They would not survive this resurrection, nor do they deserve it.
That is not ours to judge. I do this to spare war from the Council's punishment.
And what of the Nephilim? Would you save but one and not the rest?
The Nephilim are a threat to the balance.
If we had taken Eden, none of this would have happened. Yet you rode against us, slaughtered our flesh, then bound our souls in your amulet.
Who are you?
I think you know. Once, you called me brother.
Absalom.
I have forsaken that name. Now, I am corruption. The day you raised your scythe against us, I was born, and soon I will be all. The tree of life has fallen to my darkness, from withered root to fruitless limb, and even death himself will not escape it.
Hashtag corrupted death AU. Seriously, Fo, I think this scene was supposed to be very intimidating, but the camera work just completely kills it for me. There are a few very, very interesting things that he said here, though, and we'll get to it as soon as we get past the next dialogue.
Some call it the spark within that fights the darkness, that burns for life itself. But what of Death, who became the Reaper on the day he slaughtered the Nephilim? He killed his brother, his comrades, and Absalom.
Do you slay your own?
The Nephilim have no claim to Eden.
There are realms for angels and demons. Why not for us?
Eden belongs to man.
It belongs to those who take it!
The eons have not answered the question. Was it worth it? That one moment.
No!
Begot corruption. And crowned him Kinslayer.
And we're going to get into even more dialogue, so we're going to talk about all the lore stuff as soon as this conversation is over, because there's a lot to talk about.
Isn't it odd that so many have come here by your hand? And yet you so rarely visit the Dead Kingdom.
I had no plan to visit this wretched place. I sought the Tree of Life, I found it. Now I'm here.
The tree is no destination, my friend. Only a portal to other worlds. If the tree is what you seek, then you have arrived.
That I have been betrayed.
Not so hasty. The tree is wise beyond imagining. If it brought you here, then here is where you belong. Perhaps I can help.
I doubt it.
You would be wise to heed me. I have a merchant's skill to grant your deepest desire. Tell me, Ryder, what do you seek?
I would redeem my brother, restore the balance.
Yes, I have heard the tale. Your brother rode, though no call was given, and mankind paid the price.
Guard your tongue, merchant.
I give no judgment, friend. Only pass on that which I have been told. You were right to seek the tree, but it is only the gateway. What you seek is the Well of Souls.
Okay, so I'm just going to talk about Ostagoth's conversations here for a little bit, because Ostagoth is this guy's name. So basically, he implies that a tree is sentient. That the tree actually knows what it's doing, which, imagine being the tree that connects all the worlds. I gotta wonder what's going on inside the brains of that tree. And like he says, the tree is basically a portal to other worlds, and, it has brought him here. So we actually entered the tree, which is another thing in and of itself, but the tree actually brought us here again and basically spit us out in the kingdom of the dead, which is where all the souls go to after they die, except for souls like the makers who are just too old to go into the kingdom of the dead.
The Well of Souls can restore humanity.
And more! The well channels the dead into this kingdom from every world, above and below. It is also how souls are brought back into creation when they are ready to be reborn.
So yeah, that's basically how it goes in the Darksiders universe. When you die, your soul goes into the Tree of Life, into the Well of Souls, gets funneled into the Kingdom of the Dead, and then from the Kingdom of the Dead, once it's been cleansed, back into the Well of Souls to be reborn into a new realm.
You still haven't said what you are.
The history of my people was burned to ash along with our world. Forgotten even by those who destroyed them. Now, only the smoke remains. We were not the first, nor will we be the last. It is the way of things.
The way of things is balance.
And what balances life? Nothingness. Or corruption. Eventually, it consumes us all.
So it would seem. None of this explains what you're doing here.
I am merely a humble merchant with a taste for the finer things. In life and in death. I am Ostagoth, and it would amuse me to offer you my wares.
So, like he said, he's not going to tell us more about his species. We are going to find out a little bit about them through the side quest that he's going to send us on. But the way he said forgotten even by those who destroyed them kind of makes me wonder, was it the Nephilim who destroyed him, who destroyed his race? Also because, as he said, now only the smoke remains. Usually the only thing the Nephilim left behind were entire planets that were basically just ash. Just miles upon miles upon miles of ash and wind, and that's all that's left of a planet once the Nephilim are done with it. So kind of makes me wonder. Also, he said, with a taste for the finer things in life and in death. Which kind of begs the question, is Ostakov even still alive? Or is he some kind of undead creatures and all this crystal stuff that's hanging from him is actually keeping him alive? Who knows? We unfortunately never find out.
Tree of life, tree of death, portals to other worlds. I know none of this. How is it I have remained so blind, or does your tongue only spit lies?
Much was kept from the Nephilim and from the Four.
Why?
Because power must be tempered with ignorance. If the Nephilim knew the true nature of the tree, all would have perished.
I forsook the Nephilim, became a warrior for the balance, even killed my own people. I protect these worlds, you and the tree, yet still I remain in the dark.
Forsaken, yes. Forgotten? No. The Nephilim live on in you. But what do I know? I am but a simple merchant.
Now, here is the funny thing. Death does not know about the Will of Souls before he gets to this conversation. By his own admission, he does not know about the true nature of the tree. He does not know that there's the Will of Souls there or how it works. But War in Darksiders 1 does know about the Well of Souls, at the very least. He never mentions the tree because I think that's mostly because it was the first game and the designers had not yet completely sketched out the world and had not yet planned for the tree. But it does make you wonder, like, how come War knew about it, but the others, or at least Death, doesn't? Because that would sound like kind of an important thing that you would share with your fellow writers or your family. But it would make sense if that knowledge, like Ostakov said, was deliberately kept from Death only, because basically Death was the one in charge of the Nephilim soul amulet, and almost certainly the council pretty much found out through the Abomination novel events that he would defy them if he thought it necessary, that he would mess with who gets resurrected and who doesn't. And so it would make sense to keep knowledge of the Well of Souls from him, because he would be the most likely candidate to try to use the Well of Souls to basically restore the Nephilim. And we do know that erasing somebody's knowledge is actually a thing that can be done in the Darksiders universe, because in the Abomination World novel, it is made very clear that, number one, the Council stripped Lilith of a bunch of her knowledge, probably including the knowledge of how to make the Nephilim, and also that Raziel, who was an angel who fell in love outside of her assigned rank and was condemned to hell for it, was stripped of all the knowledge of Heaven's defenses and entryways before she was sent to hell. So we do know that erasing memories is a thing, and you gotta wonder, how much knowledge did the Council erase from Death and from the others to keep them in line?
What if I wish to return to the Forge Lands?
The Tree of Life has many portals, Ryder. Some may help you retrace your path. Many portals are closed, but the ones to the Forge Lands remains open.
As for the question about how the horsemen travel regularly when they are on a mission, that was actually explained in the novel, and that's what the Phantom Horses are for. Because the Phantom Horses can travel to most worlds unless there are seals or wards implemented by the owners of that world. So for example, the Council deliberately set up their realm in such a way that you cannot actually ride directly into the Council's chambers. You have to stop like several miles outside of their actual chambers and then walk to them, which extremely pisses off War in the novel that he has to do that, but that's basically how they set it up. And so, but normally the Four would use their horses for transportation, because those horses can enter a space between the realms and just basically ride through nothingness to get to where they need to go. Anyway, as soon as we get out of this conversation, Ostagoth is going to give us a neat little side quest.
Pretend that I believe you. Where should my search begin?
You must scale the Serpent's Peak and summon the Eternal Throne. There, the Lord of Bones slumbers. He will guide you to the well, or he will have your soul. Before you go, Horseman, consider this. My people may be lost, but their relics yet remain. You may come across them in your travels. They are worthless to most, but valuable to me. Return them, and I will trade relic for coin.
He will not just trade them for coin. Like, for some of them we will get coins, for some of them we will get stat upgrades, and for 5 of them we will actually get skill points. So we are definitely going to do the side quest. Okay, now I am going to move on already because we have a whole bunch of stuff to ride through. This place honestly is my least favorite location in this entire, well, second least favorite location. The least favorite thing goes to Earth. But the Kingdom of the Dead is a close second because this realm is just all grey and dull brown and everything is literally dead. It is the least imaginative, pleasant place that I could think of, and I hate that we spend so much time here. So I'm just gonna start writing, but I'm also gonna start explaining some of the lore that we had in the earlier conversations. So what we learned from that cutscene with Absalom and what we learned from the narration of the Crowfather is that Absalom essentially wanted Eden because the Nephilim did not have a realm. The Nephilim had not been planned to exist by the Creator, or at least if he had done this like kind of a long con game where he was expecting Lilith to create the Nephilim, then he did not share this plan with anyone. So the Nephilim did not have an assigned realm, they did not have a world of their own, and Absalom decided, hey, Eden looks great, let's take that. Here we have a first relic, a common relic of House Itugov, a noble family with strong ties to magic. Sell this relic to Ostagoth for your reward. So basically, the race that Ostagoth belonged to was separated into individual houses and dynasties, and they had some kind of society level where you had nobles and commoners, and this specific noble family had ties with magic. Anyway, where was I? So yeah, so he decided to take Eden as the home for the Nephilim, but the problem is that Eden was assigned to humanity, one of the 3 most important races in the universe, because they are supposed to be crucial to the maintaining of the balance in the universe. So he just had to pick the one place that was basically off limits, and that's what got all the Nephilim slaughtered. Also, we have learned now that the creation of the corruption did happen through Absalom. So when death killed him, the corruption was created in Absalom. And that honestly, that goes in line with what Muria said about corruption, where she speculated that corruption is hate given form. Because, yeah, Absalom does hate death for what he did there, rightfully so, one might say. And that hate was literally responsible for this corruption, which is the second time that the universe is getting threatened because of something Death did. In the Abomination Wars novel, what happens is that we found out that when the Nephilim were still very, very young, when they were just the firstborn, as they called themselves, which presumably was Absalom, Death, and a few others of the very, very first Nephilim, they decided to make their weapons out of a species who could shape their own bodies into tools and weapons. And this idea came from Death, because he said, hey, there's this species called the Ravaim, and they can make their own bodies into tools. Imagine how useful that would be, how versatile a weapon like that could be. Let's slaughter them and let's use their bodies for weapons. And that's exactly what they did. These weapons were so powerful that even the Nephilim themselves decided to destroy some of them because they would not want to handle them. And eventually a mad angel and a mad scientist maker tried to use those weapons to basically wreak havoc on the universe, and Death had to stop them, and that sets the entire plot of the Abomination World novel in place. And Death had literally not told anybody else, not even his own brothers and sister, about the existence of these weapons until the universe was threatened, and he was literally ordered by the council to say what was going on. So that's classic Death for you. He likes to play these cards very close to his chest. And yeah, that did not end well for anybody. And fuck me, I could not get this chain to work, so we gotta do it again. Now, other interesting things to note about that conversation, because we're not yet done. What Absalom said there about reviving humanity, he spoke about... He specifically said that Death was planning to restore humanity to a barren planet shorn of life. So that is implying that if Death resurrects humanity, they are going to get resurrected onto Earth. And yeah, Absalom is right. That would be a pretty stupid idea, because Earth is, at this point in the story, already overrun with demons, has been corrupted to hell and gone, is no longer actually all that safe for human habitation. And basically, if Death resurrects humanity and they are going to Earth, they're just going to get slaughtered again. And of course, Death's response to that was, lol, not my problem. Which also very much in line with Death, honestly. But yeah. So the only one thing that I really say that I wish we had more to deal with was that if we would actually get to see more of Absalom. Because that was his only appearance that we're going to get in-game until the final cutscene. The final boss fight, I should say. And by that point, I'm pretty sure most players have already forgotten that he exists. And I hope I did not forget any little bits of lore right now when I was thinking back about these cutscenes. One thing to note is that the Crowfather says, this moment where Death killed Absalom, crowned him Kingslayer. Kinslayer, the others also did a lot of kinslaying that day, so I'm kind of confused as to why only Death has that title, but okay. Alright, now let me just get out of here. And then I'm gonna have a quick look at what you guys were actually writing in the chat, because I was not paying attention. I was trying to get through this little mini dungeon, which we will likely come back to later, because there are some things here that we just cannot get right now. So we're gonna be back for that. Let me slap on Unstoppable, make this a little bit faster. Alright, there we go. Perfect. Okay. So, as for the question that was raised earlier in chat about the Phantom Horses not being the only means of travel, we know there are several means of travel in the Darksiders universe. There are the Phantom Horses, which... the Horsemen are not the only ones using those. We will actually see the Abyssal Riders, as they are called, which are basically demonic cavalry who also use Phantom Horses. Or, I should say, abuse Phantom Horses, because those poor animals. But we'll get to that when we get to Darksiders 1. There is also bridge stones, like the one that Ulthane gave to Fury to use for the humans. There are reflecting pools, like the ones that he used to send fury to the council, and that also we are going to use later in order to return to Earth, thanks to Archon Lucian. There are, from what I understand, a number of other portals, like specifically designed portals, that you can use. And there are probably some other means of travel as well. The thing is, travel to Earth is pretty much restricted, like Earth is a no-travel zone, and anyone who violates that is basically can get punished and will get punished with death, so... Alright, let me see if I can get that without riding despair into the abyss. Thank you. And yeah, as for the reflecting pools, not only makers can craft them, we also will later see Archon Lucian who crafts one for us. He is an angel, so apparently they can do that too. We do know that the angels can make portals into hell, because that's how they got rid of Raziel. And we do know that the makers originally had a huge network of bridge stones, which they used to travel across the universe. And which they then dismantled after angels and demons just started beating the crap out of each other. And the makers decided, okay, this is no longer safe. We'd better dismantle this before somebody else uses it for a terrible purpose. So yeah, other means of travel do definitely exist. The question is who has access to which means of travel. And that very likely depends on not just the race, but also the magical competence of the specific person in question. Now this is a Soul Arbiter's Sacred Scroll. We will find Soul Arbiter Scrolls and Soul Arbiter's Sacred Scrolls throughout the entire game. And these will be used for the Arbiter's Maze, which is the most annoying part of this entire game. I am so not looking forward to it, but we are going to do it. We are going to do it because basically it is tied to a side quest, and I do want to get that dialogue for that side quest. But we are not going to do all the secret areas of the Arbiter's Maze. We're not going to bother with that. If you do the entire Arbiter's Maze plus the secret areas, it takes around an hour and a half at least. And if you don't do the secret areas, it just cuts everything in half. It just cuts the time in half. So we're skipping all the secret areas in that maze, and we're just going about it like without that shit. And as for question from the chat about if you have missed that weird platforming section that makes me nauseous, no, that one is coming up probably at the end of the stream, because it's already like an hour and 45 minutes into the stream. We will get there, we will get to the Eternal Throne, where we will meet the Dead Lord, and yes, the way up there actually makes me nauseous. So that's going to be a lovely note to end the stream on. Anyway, for now I just want to get up here, I want to get this resistance stone and these chests, get some goodies, gear up a little. Yes, the motion sickness parkour. One of the most badass cutscenes followed by one of the worst parkour sections in the entire game, but it was thankfully robbed of its title of worst parkour section by Leviathan's Maze in Darksiders Genesis, so good job. All right. Where's the stone? There. Arcane critical damage. Who needs arcane critical damage and strength on the same object? Like, seriously? Go home, RNGesus, you're drunk. Alright, let's go. Getting... Oh, did I turn the statue? I think I did. If not, then I'm climbing up here for nothing. This is how my brain works. I'll do something and literally a minute later I'll be like, did I do this or did I not? I did. Okay, awesome.
Impossible.
Here's some damage.
I cannot.
Not really what I want.
Impossible.
There we go. Then we can finally move on to where the story is actually going to take us. 108 to 124. Exactly how good is that in comparison to what we have? It's actually much better. Oh, and it has execution chance. Okay, yeah, let's take it. Oh. Oh, I like the design of these. Okay, yeah, let's take him. All right. Time to get back to the story. Now, before we go onto that wonderful, lovely platforming section, we're going to pick up our first relic of cargo. And some loot. That was close. Okay. There we go. Let's see if we can just ignore all of these skeletons. There is a stone up here that we need to get, so let's grab that. And I guess we can talk to Volgrim in hand in the Book of the Dead chapter. It's not like we're going to do anything with it just yet, but just so we don't forget.
I have
it.
New items, if you have the coin.
I don't want your loot boxes, Volgrim. Okay, so here we got a bone key. This can only be used in the Forgelands. In the Forgelands Death Tomb, to be precise. We're not going to bother with it just yet. Let's see if we got anything nice in that chest. Not really. Okay. Alright, and here we go with one of my favorite cutscenes. Serpents, those are leviathans, so I couldn't show you any up close in Darksiders Genesis, but here they are in all their glory, except these ones are undead leviathans. And in the comic, Death once traded the tongue of a leviathan for a scythe from Volgrim, and as we saw in Darksiders 3, Volgrim turned that leviathan into a weapon enhancement which he then sold to Fury. Now we get to one of the few sections I've ever played in a game that was not VR that still makes me motion sick. So I'm gonna try to get through this as quickly as I can, because yikes. This section just does horrible things to my stomach. I will say this, there are two chests here, which if you don't pick them up right now, you will not be able to pick them up ever, because you only get to access this section once.
I cannot.
Critical damage is actually pretty good. I might put that on eventually, but I'm not gonna look at it until we're out of here. I do love the music, though. Very nice. And what the... Death, it was right in front of your face. Seriously? How did you miss that one? Get over there. There you go. Oh my god. I'm thinking I'm just gonna close my eyes for a couple seconds. There we go. This part is the worst, to be honest. Oh, I'm glad we got that over with.
Impossible.
Now we're not completely out of the woods yet, because we still got whole bunch of things moving in the background, the foreground, and so on and so forth. But the worst section is done, so that's good. And there we go, that's the end of it. Thank goodness, no more moving things on screen. Oh. I'm always so happy when I'm out of this section. Oh. Alright, and here we are at the Dead Court. Let's talk to this nice undead chap here.
Well, did the Chancellor send you? Well, horseman, I've beaten death once, and I can do it again.
I've no idea what you're talking about.
Of course not. You still reek of hope. You couldn't have met the Chancellor.
Chancellor doesn't sound like much.
For ages, his tongue has dripped venom into the dead king's ears. He all but sits upon the eternal throne, demanding service.
Who are you?
I am the Master of Blades, and all that remains of the warrior once called Draven, from the Kingdom of Man. I should have passed through the Well of Souls long ago. But I won my freedom in the arena, only to fall beneath the dead king's whip.
So that is our first indication that we should be very, very careful what kind of bargains we strike with the Lord of the Dead. Because, yeah, Draven, like I said, he used to be a human being. He died. And he said, well, yeah, if I can get a chance to go back to life by fighting in the arena, I will fight in the arena. And instead he ended up an undead member of the Dead King's court. So he can give us a bunch of training moves, none of which we're ever going to use, but might as well buy them. Should have enough money, I think. Yep, and that's it. We've just learned every single move in the entire game. Hooray. Now we're going to take a quick detour down here. We're not going to smash all of these crates, because these are actually very useful. If you run out of health potions and you don't want to buy health potions, you can smash a lot of these crates and get at least two or three potions. So that's nice. But we are going to... we are going to get this stone. There we go. And there should be a Boatman coin somewhere in here. Ah, there it is. Okay, cool. And of course a Serpent Tome, which we don't need right now. So we're just going to talk to the Chancellor, and he's going to give us another quest, and then we're going to call it a day, because that next quest is a whole new dungeon, which is going to take us a bit of time to get through.
No one disturbs the Lord of Bones without say of his Chancellor.
A rider? In the Kingdom of the Dead? No, no, this will never do.
I must speak with the Lord of Bones.
Oh, that is not possible. My lord attends his realm. A burden beyond even your ken, horseman.
And what is your use as a doorstop?
There is but one way to draw him from his slumber. The Gilded Arena. Here mortals are offered a last chance to earn freedom from the grave. A boon that includes an audience with the king. Defeat the arena's champion and return here with its skull. His Majesty will grant you an audience.
And where is this arena?
Yeah, we saw how well this turned out for Draven, right?
Fret not, horseman. We have already arrived.
Let me speak to the Lord of Bones, and I will spare your champion. And perhaps you as well, Chancellor.
You cannot slay that which is already dead.
But you're welcome to try. In the arena.
Forget what I said about sparing you, doorkeeper.
I think this would actually be like nice aggression therapy, just having an undead body to hack into forever.
Tell me about the King of the Dead.
His reign is eternal. His word is law. And his time is invaluable. I ensure that he need only speak with those who are worthy.
Then you must rarely see him, Chancellor. Oh.
I love the banter between these two. But I do like that he says his reign is eternal. Did he say the same thing about Argul? Because Argul did not reign eternal. Remember, this Lord of the Dead is not the first Lord of the Dead. Before him, there was Argul.
What does Echidna have to do with your kingdom? Last I heard, she had one of her own.
The Shadow Realm, Issylic, yes. Where the Sisters Sightless spin their webs. Many of my lord's foes escaped there when his rule was still young. We hunted them down. Echidna herself barely escaped. Perhaps she took shelter here, and yet weaves her evil.
So now we know why Fane could not find Echidna in the Shadow Realm, even though he went there. Because the Dead King's subjects had come in to look for all the people who had followed Argul and had basically run everybody out of that realm.
Your king is not the first to rule here, is he, Chancellor?
There was another. A creature called Argul. Too mad to be kept upon the throne. I helped my lord be rid of him, and even destroyed a few of his servants.
Oh, I get an old star.
What will my lord do without me? Do take care in the arena, horseman. Should anything happen to you, I'm not sure if I could live with myself.
I love this snarky asshole. Okay, anyway, so yeah, from here on out, we basically have to go fight in the arena to meet the Lord of Bones and basically rip him out of his very busy schedule of sleeping for millennia in order to ask him how to get to the Well of Souls. And he's going to send us on an entire separate thing of quests, and it's just going to be dungeons upon dungeons upon dungeons upon dungeons, and you're really going to learn to hate the number three. All of that next time. For now, we are done. We're going to end the stream here. Thank you guys for joining me. I'm very sorry about the technical difficulties we had in the beginning. And I hope to see you guys again next Sunday, 8 p.m. Irish time as usual. Until then, thank you very much for being here. Have a good week and have a happy Christmas or whatever other holidays you might be celebrating, or just enjoyable winter break or whatever. And I'll see you again next Sunday. Until then, have a good one and stay safe. Bye-bye.